Already so much has been said by listening to your feedback. We'll just recap briefly what we discussed in the 2 days. So we started by discussing the need for human education sanskar, and we saw that there is a need for human worldview, a human perspective, so that there is an understanding of human values in the student, you know, and based on this understanding of human values only he can pick the right skills. And then we also saw that to understand human values or to take it to any regular curriculum, certain basic guidelines have to be obeyed. And one of the basic guidelines is that it has to be universal. And you can see that in the past 2 days, whatever we are discussing is something universal, applying to every human being. Similarly, it has to be rational. You know? It cannot be just a sermon kind of thing that something is prescribed for you and you have to go by it. You know? So there is certainly a difference between human value and moral value. So moral value, when you talk about it, you try to prescribe certain things. We try to make some code of conduct, you know, give some stories and then try to motivate the other person. But we are not trying to motivate anybody. You know? Rather, in this process, what we are trying to do is to reason out everything, right? To make it rational and verify it on one's own right, right? And then it has to be leading to harmony. It has to lead to harmony, right? So these are the certain basic guidelines. And when we go by these basic guidelines, we can see that this kind of content can be taken to any corner of the world. Yeah. This can be universalized across the boundaries of the nations, across the boundaries of states, across the boundaries of sects, isn't it? When the student is able to contemplate these values and pick the right skills, then he is able to live with human conduct, and then he can be a pillar of the human society. And then our skill education can be value guided, right? And we can be a part of just and equitable society. So we saw that this is the complete paradigm of human consciousness. When we are able to ensure right understanding in the self, we are able to ensure justice in the relationship with human being, and we are able to participate in the larger order with nature. You know? And while doing this, we are able to ensure mutual happiness in our interaction with the human being. And when we are able to ensure justice in the relationship with human being, that spreads from family to the world family. So this mutual happiness that starts from one-to-one interaction slowly becomes a part of the undivided society. So now, using this term undivided society and talking of the whole world may look a little far-fetched result. But the good thing is that the moment you are able to contemplate these values in relationship, and you yourself become a pillar of the undivided society. And this is the way the message has to go. This is the way slowly the education has to get transformed so that each one of us becomes a pillar of undivided society, right? Unless you understand this, we ourselves are divided. We are divided in families. We are divided within ourselves, you know, having the feeling of opposition for somebody. But once I have these right feelings in me, and I become undivided within myself, I become undivided in my family, and slowly I become a pillar of the undivided society. Similarly, by understanding the need for physical facility correctly, and as all of you could see, and many of you have shared also the shift that we are able to see in terms of feeling of prosperity. Now, we, with a feeling of prosperity, are able to ensure a family order, some orderliness in the family, right? And that orderliness in the family slowly becomes a part of the world family order, right? And then we become a pillar of the universal human order. So this kind of clarity is to be given through education. In place of motivating the child for maximization of profit, for earning unlimited wealth, and becoming the best in the world, we need to give this kind of vision to the child. For every college, we make vision, mission, objective, isn't it? So let us think, can we have this as the vision of our institute? Can this be vision of any program that we are going for, any research that we are conducting, any course that we are teaching? Can this be a vision for that particular thing? So once this gets embedded in our vision, then we'll see that in your every program that you make, whether at the level of family or at the level of organization or at the level of your colony or your society, your district, your state, your nation, or the whole world, wherever you try to opt for any program, chalk out any program, this will become the basic guiding factor. So let us see whether our organization can have this kind of vision. We all keep on setting vision for the organizations, for the institutions, for the companies, right? But unless our organization is having a vision which can take us to undivided society and universal human order, in the long run, we are going to suffer. We try to look at the profit in the short run many a times, right? But in the long run, we do suffer. Due to this lockdown, all of us are suffering, isn't it? When there is a chaos in the society, when there is a war, you know, all of us suffer. So we have to see things in continuity. Something, and continuity means for every moment. You know, we need to appreciate this, that we want happiness in continuity. And for that, we have to have program which can ensure a definiteness in continuity, not in the short run. So this whole understanding of human consciousness is very basic. It's very basic. So this kind of transformation is required. You know? It just appears on a slide, you know, as a very small picture. But ultimately, if you see, this can transform our whole life. This can transform our whole organization, our policies at the level of state, at the level of nation. So in place of working for maximization of physical facilities, we have to work for this kind of transformation, because ultimately the happiness is required for the self. You know? And the self can be happy only when the self is able to live with human consciousness, right? So we are exploring into the basic requirements for this kind of transformation. We saw that the complete content of right understanding is to understand the harmony at these four levels. Harmony in the human being, harmony in the family, harmony in the society, and harmony in nature and existence. Right? And this is basically the essence of education. And when I go to live accordingly, then this is sanskar. And when I go to live accordingly, then I involve skills also. So all the technologies that we are teaching, you know, the courses that we are offering, and basically is to enable the child to fulfill the needs, you know, fulfill the needs, ensuring all the three, right understanding in the self, relationship with human being, and physical facility with the rest of nature. And the content of right understanding, is this, the harmony at all the four levels. Then we also said that whatever is being said is a proposal, and we do not have to assume it to be true or false, but rather we have to verify on our own right. And when we go to verify, we have to take everything that is being said as a proposal. You know? And then there's something called natural acceptance. And you can see that we have been referring to it time and again, and we'll keep referring to it. In a single workshop, we use this word not less than 1,000 times, right? Because this is the core of it. Unless I'm able to refer the proposal to my natural acceptance, I cannot verify it. And second thing that is required to be done is to validate it in our experience, to live accordingly, right? Now, when I go to live accordingly, and I behave with human beings, and in that behavior, I expect mutual happiness. So when I'm able to ensure mutual happiness, and that also in continuity through my conduct, right? Then this certifies that, yes, I have understood the thing rightly. It is not only a thought, but it is a part of my understanding. So through this, I'm able to make out that, yes, this is a part of my understanding. Similarly, when I interact with the rest of nature and I'm able to see that, yes, this is ensuring mutual prosperity, I'm also able to fulfill my need, and the nature is also becoming prosperous day by day, then this also certifies. So through this process, I'm able to transform myself. I'm able to reach the state of right understanding. Then we define happiness and prosperity also. And we saw that happiness is to be in a state of harmony. And this is, as somebody was saying also, that when you look at the desires in the self, you know, they are very limited. And if you see, the core desire is to be happy and prosperous. And there also you can see that happiness is nothing but to be in a state of harmony. Simply, prosperity is nothing but the feeling of having more than required physical facility. The moment we are able to see this at the level of our natural acceptance, it comes very clearly to us. You know? Without any confusion, without any contradiction, without any conflict, right? And then only that I have to make a program for it. Then we talked about harmony in the human being, and we saw that a human being is coexistence of two distinct realities. One is the self, which is the conscious entity, and one is the material, which is the material entity, a body, which is the material entity. And I am coexisting with my body. So self is nothing but I, me. So when I'm talking to you, Hannah, self, this one, Hannah, is talking to you. And my body is working as an instrument. Your body is also working as an instrument for you. So I am communicating with you, and my body is working as an instrument for myself. Your body is working as an instrument for yourself. You can see that the needs of your body are quite temporary and limited in quantity. They are all quantitative, while your need is continuous. Your need is qualitative. And your need is going to be fulfilled by right understanding and right feeling, same as mine. So you might have read so many things regarding this. Some words came up yesterday, like mind or this or that. putting them all as a proposal again, but on the side for time being, let us start observing ourselves. Let us start observing ourselves and see whether I need this or not, whether they are going to be fulfilled by right understanding, right feeling, or something else. Here also we can see that the needs of the body are going to be fulfilled only by physiochemical things. And the activities of the body, you can all see that these are all, you know, material activities, you know, which are temporary in nature. But my activities are conscious activities, sentient activities, desire, thought, expectation, which are all continuous. And the response of the body again is limited to only two things, recognizing and fulfilling, right? But my activities at least have the activity of assuming. I assume and accordingly I recognize and fulfill. And the only thing is that if I come to know, you know, the things as they are, my assumption becomes definite, right? Otherwise it remains indefinite, and then recognition and fulfillment also remains indefinite. And we took some examples also to illustrate this. Then we talked about harmony in the self, and we saw that the content of imagination can have three sources. One is the preconditioning, something that I have come to assume. And as we go along in the discussion today, we can see that there are so many preconditionings that we have nurtured in ourselves. You know, we can also see that one source for imagination is sensation. You know, some information that I'm getting from the body, the sense organs, you know, through my sight, my touch, my smell, my taste, you know, all this. And then it also may influence my imagination. But a third source is there, which is natural acceptance. And all the time, what we are trying to do is to refer to this third source. You know? And the more I refer to this, I become more self-organized. Otherwise, I'm enslaved. This is a state of enslavement. Anybody comes to me, you know, and pumps something into my self, in my desire, in my thought, and I become enslaved. Somebody says that your clothes is not looking good, I become enslaved and start up thinking, changing my clothes. Somebody says that your car is not up to the up to your status, and I start thinking. You know, somebody says that, you know, he has purchased some thing in some bungalow there in the city outside, and you start thinking in terms of that. So this is all enslavement. Anybody can come and dictate you. This is enslavement. Similarly, our sensations many times dictate us, and this is also enslavement. But when I'm able to do this, verify on my own right and then decide, then I'm self-organized. So what is intended is to have this kind of state where I have the right understanding ensured in me. And then my complete content of imagination is guided by right understanding, never by preconditioning or sensation. So whatever comes to me, I'll take it as a proposal, verify it for myself, and then find out myself. And whenever I verify, I refer to my natural acceptance. Now, when I'm able to reach this state, right, then there is complete harmony between my natural acceptance and my competence. And that is to say what I really want to be and what I am. So what I am is now the same as what I really want to be. There is no gap there. We saw yesterday that there is a vast gap between what I am and what I really want to be. But what we intend to do is not to have any gap, but rather this coherence, this harmony. And then I am in a state of harmony in continuity. I am in a state of happiness in continuity. Next, we talked about harmony of self with the body. And we saw that body is my instrument, right? And its needs are different, you know, my needs are different. And when I'm able to see this body as my instrument, I become more responsible to the body. And this feeling of responsibility towards the body is self-regulation. So when I become responsible, I take care of the nurturing of the body, protecting the body, and utilizing the body rightly, right? And for each of these, I can see that the need is limited. For nurturing the body. In fact, we can see that most of the diseases that we are getting today, or many of the diseases that we are getting today, is because of overeating or consuming something which is not required, right? It is more than required. We have seen through surveys in the villages of Kanpur that in Kanpur, a common thing that you use is called as gutkha, which is a kind of, you know, masala that people eat, right? And it consumes a good amount of income from them, whosoever eats gutkha. Right, and whether this is going to nurture the body or not. So we can see that when I'm able to understand the need of my body clearly, then whatever I consume for nurturing ensures health. And I can also see that it is required in limited quantity. Similarly, we can make out that for protection, clothes and shelter that are required are limited in quantity. Similarly for instruments. And then with this, I have a better clarity of prosperity for me.